Good morning, church. Let's start off with a praise song this morning.
My hope is built on nothing less. Jesus' blood and righteousness. I did not trust the sweetest frame, but wholly trust in Jesus' name.
Come on, every voice.
My hope is built on nothing less. Jesus' blood and righteousness. I did not trust the sweetest frame, but wholly trust in Jesus' name. Christ alone, cornerstone, we can make strong. Saved love through the storm. He is the Lord, Lord of all. When darkness seems to hide his face, I rest on his unchanging grace. Every high and stormy gale, my anchor holds within the veil. My anchor holds within the veil. Oh, Christ alone, cornerstone, we made strong.
Thank you.
Well, welcome. It's great to have you here today. You can be seated. Let me tell you some things that are happening here in the life of the church. Our deadline for our Easter flowers is April 3rd. Just to let you know, Easter, we'll have the three services. We'll have a Monday, Thursday service here at 7 o'clock. And we need some disciples. If you're interested in playing a disciple, there's no lines. You just have to wear a little costume. And we're going to do a live portrayal of the Last Supper. And that'll be on Thursday night. We'll have the Tenebrae service at the Lutheran Church. And then we have our Easter services, the three services on Sunday morning. Our order deadline for flowers are April 3rd. The Saegertown Craft Show is this week. Our craft show here at the church, it's from 9 to 3. Setup is on Friday. If you're able to help, we can talk with Tiffany about that. Let lunch this week is going to be here at noon. And we also have our soup for seniors this week with broccoli cauliflower cheddar soup being the soup of the week. Grow Kids and Youth Group tonight at 6 to 7:30. Any other announcements? Tiffany?
Reminder that there is no planning meeting tomorrow, so for the craft fair.
No planning. We've been meeting every week for craft fair planning, but we will not meet this week. Any other announcements? Well, with that said, let's continue our worship this morning in the name of God, the Father, God, Son, and Holy Spirit. I think we have a little announcement. Next week is Umcor Sunday. Umcor is an organization that does a lot of relief for disaster. One of the things that's beautiful about Umcor is all the money that goes to Umcor does not cover like office expenses. It goes to the disaster or the place that we're sending it to. So let's take a look. We have a few slides to show you.
Umcor Sunday is early for us this year because of the urgent need in Turkey and Syria. For more than 50 years, United Methodist congregations have been taking part in a special offering, laying the foundation for the United Methodist Committee on Relief's Ministry of Relief and Hope. Umcor's work of alleviating human suffering around the world includes disaster relief and supplies, disaster risk reduction, health and humanitarian development. This ministry is achieved exclusively through your generosity. In 2022, you gave almost $2.2 million, which provided hope and safety for communities and individuals whose lives have been upset by storms, wars, fires, displacement, and climate change. The special offering on this Sunday underwrites Umcor's cost of doing business, making it possible for Umcor to focus on responding to communities and individuals when they need immediate assistance. It allows Umcor to preserve the promise that 100% of any donation to a specific Umcor project or missionary will go towards that project and not administrative costs. Please consider extra giving today by designating your donation for Umcor on your check. Thank you so much for your giving.
Umcor Sunday is next Sunday, so if you would like to make an offering for that, if you want to bring another envelope and just write Umcor on it and place it in the offering. Let's continue our worship and invite the kids forward for a children's moment.
So are any of you in Boy Scouts or Girl Scouts? Anybody? Well, if you aren't, so you might be familiar with the motto, be prepared. That's their motto. And so if you were going on a camping trip, you would want to be prepared, wouldn't you? And make sure that you have a flashlight. But what else would you want to do? You'd want to make sure that it works. And if you were really extra prepared, you would make sure that you had more batteries. So if these ones die, then you can replace them with the good batteries, and then your flashlight's still going to work. So that would be being prepared. We want to be well prepared. So that's a good motto, isn't it? Well, Jesus told a story in the Bible, and it was about 10 bridesmaids, and they took their oil lamps, and they went out to meet the bridegroom. So an oil lamp would have been like what we, a flashlight in our day. But back in the Bible times, they would have used oil lamps, and their fuel wouldn't have been batteries. It would have been oil. That's what would have lit their oil lamp. Well, Jesus said 5 of the 10 were foolish because when it was time to go and meet the bridegroom, they were out of oil. However, the other 5, they were wise and they were well prepared because they brought plenty of oil for their lamps. And when it was time to go meet the bridegroom, they were ready. So in this story, the bridegroom is Jesus, and we are the bridesmaids. And the story is teaching us that one day we're going to go and we're going to meet Jesus. So what do we need to do? We need to be prepared because we don't know when that time is coming. Even Jesus doesn't know when he's going to come back. Well, to be prepared, we need to make sure we've asked Jesus into our heart. And then when we believe that he died for our sin and ask him into our hearts, then we're ready. And then in the meantime, we want to make sure that we're telling others about him so they can ask him into their heart also. So that's what we need to do to be prepared. So let's have a word of prayer. Heavenly Father, we know that one day we're going to meet you face to face. So help us to be ready. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Okay. I've got a treat for you and you can head off to Sunday school.
Let's take a moment this morning and greet one another in the name of Christ. Join together if you can this morning as we share together our Lenten symbol. We've been celebrating the different Lenten symbols during the season of Lent. First Sunday we had the cross. The second Sunday we had the silver coins. Today we're looking at the scourge. And let's join together. Then Pilate took Jesus and had him flogged. The soldiers twisted together a crown of thorns and put it on his head. Congregation. Once more, Pilate came out and said to the Jews gathered there, "Look, I am bringing him out to you to let you know that I find no basis for a charge against him." As soon as the chief priests and the officials saw him, they shouted, "Crucify, crucify." So we continue to celebrate the symbols. Let's give our praises up to God who has done so much for us. And let's sing our next hymn if you're able to stand as we sing together, Glorious Day.
One day when heaven was filled with his praises, one day when sin was as black as could be, Jesus came forth to be born of a virgin, dwelt among men, my example is he. The word
Word became flesh, and the light shined among us, His glory revealed. Living, He loved me. Dying, He saved me. Buried, He carried my sins far away. Rising, He justified freely forever. One day He's coming, oh glorious day, oh glorious day. One day they left Calvary's mountain. One day they nailed Him to die on a tree. Suffering, anguish, despised and rejected. Bearing our sins, my Redeemer is He. Hands that heal nations stretched out on a tree. He took the nails for me. Dying, He saved me. Buried, He carried me. My sins far away. Rising, He justified freely forever. One day He's coming, oh glorious day.
Seated. Scripture passage this morning, we find Jesus telling a parable, and this is what He says. At that time, the kingdom of heaven will be like 10 virgins who took their lamps and went out to meet the bridegroom. 5 of them were foolish and 5 were wise. The foolish ones took their lamps but did not take oil with them. The wise ones, however, took oil in jars along with their lamps. The bridegroom was a long time in coming, and they all became drowsy, and they fell asleep. At midnight, the cry rang out, "Here's the bridegroom. Come out to meet him." And then all the virgins woke up. They trimmed their lamps, and the foolish ones said to the wise, give us some oil, for our lamps are going out. No, they replied, there may not be enough for both us and you. Instead, go to those who sell oil and buy some for yourselves. But while they were on their way to buy the oil, the bridegroom arrived. And the virgins who were ready went in with him to the wedding banquet, and the door was shut. Later, the others also came. Lord, Lord, they said, open the doors for us. But he replied, truly I tell you, I don't know you. Therefore, keep watch, because you do not know the day or the hour. This is the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. Let's pray. Lord God, as we come before your word today, we're tired. We are, we've been busy. We've been all over the place. Our schedules are nuts sometimes. And Lord, we just ask that in this moment, in this very moment, that we would not be distracted by all that, but that we would be focused on you, that we would be able to let your word come alive in us, that we would be able to take it, that we'd be able to grasp hold of it, and that we would be able to live it. And we just pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. So one of the things that that I have been doing in the last few years is preparing for retirement. Now, we should always be planning for that. We should start planning, actually, for retirement when we start our career. If you remember, there was a gentleman here that did his internship my first summer here. His name is Kyle Eisenhuth. And Kyle texted me a while back saying, I want to tell you my retirement year. And I said, okay. And he said, 2066. And I said, don't expect me to be at your retirement party. I am planning for my retirement. It's not the start of my career, so I'm a little bit late, but I still have time because it's going to be a while yet. But there are questions like, will I have enough? Maybe that's what you're asking too. Enough to live? Will I be able to travel? Will I be able to upgrade the house that I'm going to be living in the way that I want to? Now, I have done some things lately, like I have talked to an investment agent, and we have some things going on. I've paid into a pension for years. I've purchased a home, so I have equity. And like a lot of us, I don't know if you've done this, but I'm starting a bucket list. How many of you guys have a bucket list? Do you have a bucket list? So anyway, it's important to plan. And you know what? One of the things that my parents did, and it really helped us out in the time of their death, was they planned for their funeral arrangements. That might sound a little bit morbid, but they planned for it, and they paid for it. And one of the things that was a beautiful thing with that was that when we were going through our grief and our mourning, we did not have to plan a service, for it was already planned. So preparing and planning is important. It's important. Yes, we have the spontaneity, and the wind blows where the Spirit is going to blow, and we really need to live into that, probably a lot more than we do. But planning is important, and God works, I believe the Holy Spirit works through planning and organization as well. If we say it doesn't, then we're limiting God. We should be prepared. And this is what Jesus is talking about and teaching us in this parable this morning. For you see, we believe that Jesus came into the world. We celebrate that at Christmas, right? He comes in the form of a baby, comes into the manger, and then he lives and teaches his disciples and tells us some of the things that we need to know about the character of God and how to live through his parables, through his miracles. And then he is sacrificed. He is crucified. He dies on the cross. But like the song said, death could not hold him, and he rises again to show us that we too will have eternal life. But the thing that we believe now after that is that he ascended, and he's going to come back. We believe that with all our heart, at least I do, that he will be back. He will usher his kingdom in. And according to what we read today, we need to be ready. We need to be prepared. Not prepared necessarily for our retirement, but prepared for his return. Because in other scripture passages, it says that he will come like a thief in the night. So then if we read scripture and we believe that someday Jesus is coming back, we will need to be ready. We will need to be prepared. And this is what Jesus is talking about in this parable, being prepared. And how does he teach that? Well, he teaches it in the form of a parable. And what is a parable? Well, each of Jesus' parables are so different that they could be defined in different ways. One way to say it is it's an illustration, but that's not a complete definition. One author I read when I was preparing this week said that parables are imaginary gardens with real toads. I like that. Simply said, they are imaginary stories with real truth. For example, look at the parable of the prodigal son, probably one of the most popular or famous parables that Jesus tells. There really is no son and no father, just a story, but there's a real truth of the love of the father. So in the parable that we are looking at today, we know it is a story that Jesus is telling. There were really not 10 virgins. They were characters in a story. But there is a real truth to be learned. And we therefore need to learn this truth so that we can apply it to our life. And in the parable, we see that Jesus is talking about 5 wise virgins and 5 foolish ones. And they are waiting for the bridegroom. The wise ones took their lamps with them and had oil in a jar so that they could light them. They were wise. And the foolish ones took their lamps, but they had no oil. And at midnight, the bridegroom announces his coming. And they had no oil. And they all woke up and they trimmed their lamps, but the foolish ones asked for oil from the wise ones. But the wise ones said no, because there would not be enough for both of them. The wise ones said to the foolish ones, go and buy some oil. Now, this must have been pre-pandemic because it was midnight and there must have been a store open. We don't see them open anymore all night long. But there must have been some all-night oil store that they could go to. And while the foolish ones were off to buy the oil, the bridegroom came. And the virgins were off buying the oil, they missed the bridegroom. And those that were ready, well, they got to go to the wedding feast. And the bridegroom even says in the scripture that he didn't know the foolish ones. So this is an imaginary story with the real truth. And what is the truth? Well, we need to be ready. We need to be ready. We need to be prepared. The bridegroom is coming for his bride. One of the cultural things we need to know at the time that Jesus was telling this parable is wedding customs in Jesus' day would see that the bridegroom would return from the house of the bride in a procession leading to his own home where a wedding banquet would be enjoyed by all. Now, if we look at other passages of Scripture, we can see Christ being called the bridegroom. And the church is referred to as the bride. Jesus is coming for his bride, his church, the church. And we said earlier that Jesus is indeed coming back. And the question is, when we look at it, will the church be wise or is it distracted and foolish? That is a question that we need to ask ourselves over and over again. And as we look at the ministries of the church, we need to be asking, are we indeed ready? And I think one of the things we need to be asking when determining whether we are ready is, are we united? Now, I want to share another scripture with you. And I find this one to be kind of daunting and somewhat scary when I look at it, because it makes us think about where we might be if we are not united. It is also the words of Jesus. It is also found in the Gospel of Matthew. It is also truth. So look at this one with me. Matthew chapter 12, 25. Jesus knew their thoughts and said to them, "Every kingdom divided against itself will be ruined, and every city or household divided against itself will not stand." Jesus is saying that we must be united, or maybe we will be foolish and not ready. Now, I talked last week about being united. If you remember, we looked at the prayer that Jesus prayed in the garden. He prayed that we would all be one, and that we would be one as the Father and the Son are one, that we would all be united in one. To be united, we show wisdom. And one of the ways that we are learning, and that if we look at Scripture and that I am relearning, is that if we are the way that we are most united is in how we love. Love covers a multitude of sins. Love means putting the other first. Making disciples becomes more important than our politics when we love others. Most important as to how we spend our finances and time. We must be united in how we love, how we are in our servanthood. And this is a question that we must ask ourselves. Are we wise? Are we foolish? Are we united? Are we asking each other, how is it with your soul? Because that's one of the ways that we love each other, is by asking each other how we're doing, by putting the other first. Now, you might be thinking, why are you telling us this? Of course we are putting the other first. We are doing things. We did the tractor parade. We have our funeral dinners. We're having an Easter egg hunt for the community. We have Bible studies. We do this. We do that. We shine at Vacation Bible School. But here's the real question. With all of those things that we're doing, we need to ask this one question too. Why are we doing it? Why are we doing those things? Is it because of reason? Well, it's June, and that's when we have Vacation Bible School. Is it tradition? That's when we have our Vacation Bible School. Our reason that we need to bring people into the church so that we can give more and can have more money to do things for their community? Is it because of experience? If we do a funeral dinner, our experience is we might get to be with good friends at church. And you know what? I will also get a good meal. Folks, all of those things are good. But the underlying question that we must constantly ask when we're doing things is, how are we loving? Where is our heart? Are we doing this because we are loving? Even if we look at the Scriptures and know the Scriptures backwards and forwards, we need to check this. You know, the Pharisees knew the Scriptures backwards and forwards, and they were trying to live these things out. But their hearts were not in the right place. They were not loving. They were not putting the other first. Are we putting the other first? Are we loving? You know what? Jesus tells us to do two different things. To love God with our whole heart, soul, and mind. And you know what? That's such an easy thing for me to do. I love God with everything that I have and with all my heart, soul, and mind. But then he says we must do something else too. We must love our neighbor as ourselves. Why couldn't Jesus just stop at the loving God part? That's the easy part, right? But this loving our neighbor stuff, it becomes pretty tricky and really hard. Even the people at Jesus' time knew that it wasn't going to be easy. Why are we doing the craft show this week? Why are we doing Vacation Bible School? Is it because we love our community so much that we want to share the truth with them? The biblical truth? Why do we worship on Sunday mornings? Is it because we love people enough to be with others and fellowship with them and focus on the perfect love of God? We need to be ready, folks. We really do. Ready for that day when the bridegroom comes back for his bride. It could be a few minutes from now. We may not get home from church today. And it could be thousands of years after our deaths. We don't know, but we need to be ready. We need to be ready. And I believe the way to prepare ourselves is by living what Jesus calls us to do. And if you read scripture after scripture after scripture, we can say the words that flow from his mouth are, be careful in how you love. Not who you love. Jesus teaches us in other parables that God will take care of those who need to be taken care of. He's going to separate the wheat from the tares. And sometimes that's really hard for us to see. But we are given the responsibility to love. And I invite you to stay with me this as we explore that. Come Sunday after Sunday, get involved and look and see how we can love. Learn the love of Jesus. And that with that, I believe if we are processing that and we are doing that, we will be wise, not foolish. We will be ready for when Jesus comes and knocks at our door. We will be prepared. We will be known as Christian people united by our love. Let's pray. Lord God, we thank you for the opportunity to love. We thank you for the opportunity to give. We thank you for the opportunity to be prepared and to be united. And we just pray that you would continue to do a work within us. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. So as we take some time to do corporate prayer this morning, let's think about some things that we can be praying for. Anybody have any prayer concerns to lift up today? Sue, please. Did you say bub? Okay. Okay, so we'll be praying for Bub and his heart. Okay, there's a gentleman that comes to the 8 o'clock service, the brother of Dean. His name is Gene Hamilton, and he's having his heart worked on tomorrow. So we can be praying for Gene tomorrow. I guess they said that they're going to freeze his heart, do some work on it. So we can be praying for him as well. So Bub and Gene, anything else to be praying for? Okay, well, let's take some time to pray. Lord God, one of the things that it says in Scripture is to be still and to know that you are God. And one of the hard things that we have, one of the things that's very hard for us to do is to be still. And therefore, Lord, I feel sometimes we don't know who you are because we're going to the next thing, the next event, the next item on our list to do. And we're not taking the time to be still. And so as we take a moment here today, Lord, help us to be still. and help us to know that you are indeed God. That you love us with a love that we cannot even comprehend, that's overwhelming, and that's why when we read scripture that the folks that were in your physical presence were overwhelmed, it was because of your love, your overwhelming love. That's why you sent your son for us. For we read the scripture, it says, for you loved the world so much that you gave your only son. We thank you for the love. We are overwhelmed. But may we be still and know that you are God. And Lord, as we pray that this morning, we just confess that there are times when we are distracted. There are times that we sin. There are times that we are focused on the things that divide instead of the things that unite. And we ask for your forgiveness. Help us to be wise and not foolish. And Lord, we also want to just thank you for the work on the cross, the things that Jesus has done for us, the promise of everlasting life. But in the midst of it, Lord, we thank you for the way you've taught us how to live. We thank you for the parables. May they transform us as people that follow you. And Lord, as we do that and live those things out, we have some things that are on our hearts this morning. And we want to pray for that. We pray for Bub and for Jean as they have some issues with their hearts. And we pray, Lord, for healing. We pray for those who are experiencing loss today. We lift them up. We pray for those who are caregivers, Lord. We pray that you would give them the strength that they need. Lord, there are many folks that we could probably even think of this morning that are so distracted by things like addiction, financial needs, physical sickness or health. We lift them up to you. Pray that they would be able to see you and feel your overwhelming surrounding presence. And Lord, as we think about that this morning, we also think about the way that you taught us many things. And one of the things that you taught us is how to pray. And so as we take this time and close this time together, we think about the prayer that you taught us and we say it together and we say, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. And forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, power, and the glory forever. Amen. So as we continue to worship today, let me remind you that part of worshiping is giving. And if you feel called to be a part of our offering this morning, our offering plates are near the door. Let's take some time as we look at this video this morning and continue to lift up our praises and thank God for how much He has given us. Thank you. Lord God, we thank you for this opportunity to give, and we ask that you would help us to use these finances to help prepare for your coming. Help us to communicate this truth to your community. Help us to live into your kingdom, and help us to know your overwhelming love. We just pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. So as we close our worship today, let's close in our closing hymn, Blessed Assurance. You want to stand?
Bye.
Just an announcement is in a couple weeks, we're going to have our One Service Sunday. And it is a spring service. We're asking everybody to wear spring colors that day. So if you have some pastels that you might want to wear on that Sunday so we can brighten up the church and celebrate new life. We're also having a kind of a tureen afterwards, and we're asking people if you want to stay and have lunch with us. If you are from A through L, to bring soup. If you're from M through Z, to bring a salad. So we'll celebrate and fellowship that day. But let's go forth now, being prepared and seeking to be wise in how we do that, in how we love one another. And let's go forth knowing that the love comes from the Father, and the grace comes from the Son, and that the Holy Spirit continues to do a work within and through us. And let's go forth in peace. Amen.